I really probably do need you guys to spread out some because technically you're supposed to be socially distanced. So if that means moving and spreading out involving another pew, I'd prefer they be the pews towards the front. Very good. Thank you. All right, so I have a variety of information to share with you, primarily related to curriculum, but there's also some college planning information. I'm hoping that this is helpful to you, thinking not only about the course request process today and ultimately what you'll do seventh period by selecting those things, also just the college planning piece. We were all talking just a few minutes ago about trying to take advantage of time, and that is a big part of what helps relieve the stress as far as applications and all the various things that go into them. So we'll just move right in. As far as a timetable for you all and where we are in the process, the opening today is when you're actually making your course requests. As far as a opportunity for those requests, we're showing that as a March 1 closing date. It's kind of a loose date, but nonetheless, hopefully you will have made decisions about your requests and had conversations with teachers as necessary by then. Our hope is, as soon as all of this information is compiled, not just yours, but the underclassmen as well, we just are able to start working on the master schedule that much sooner, okay? As far as discussions and questions and so forth, there will be a chance not only today to go over and talk a little bit about the requests you're making, but much more detail when you meet with us for your family spring conferences. The prerequisites in the curriculum guide, if there's ever a question about what it is that maybe one of the reasons why you're not able to select one of the requests that you're making, go back and look at the curriculum guide, which is actually available to you now on your student resources. And also when it comes to conflicts, I said this in first period with you guys too, if there's a question about what a teacher has recommended, you're gonna have to have the conversation with the teacher as well. Reminder, and this again is just a screenshot of what is in the curriculum guide, one of the first pages related to our graduation requirements. And these are reviewed with your advisor at every meeting that we have, but you need to keep that in mind too as you're putting together your senior schedule. What is it that you have to do in order to fulfill the requirements that are listed here? In terms of the science and the social science, just a reminder, the numbers there, essentially between the two areas, you have to earn 7 credits. If you opt to do 3 science, that means you have to do 4 social studies, or the reverse. If you opt to do 4 science, you would have to do 3 social studies. Most of you end up taking more than that in both areas, but nonetheless, that's the requirement to meet our graduation expectations. World language 3 rather than just 2, and the first 2 really are consecutive. The fine arts requirement of 1, and then as far as the religion and the PE, they're listed there. In terms of exemptions for portions of your PE, it really comes from having played a varsity sport, and we can talk more about that if we need to. Additional to the actual credits that you have to earn, the service component. It's not gone away and it's not changed. I know that COVID makes it more difficult sometimes to find the different opportunities for service, although that's opening up and I'm learning more and more about students that have been able to find significant service opportunities. One of the reasons that it's an important aspect to your education, we feel, that service learning component, but in addition to just trying to give back to our community, it's also required for Florida Bright Futures. So we want to make sure that you're able to qualify for that, those of you that are Florida residents. This is also something that is in the handbook. When we talk about trying to help students decide whether or not they should take AP classes. Keep this in mind. You are going into a very extremely busy year, your senior year. You've probably had a rigorous schedule already this year. You need to think very carefully about the combination of classes and the actual balance to your life, whether you're really busy outside because of sports or if you have a part-time job and just want to be able to enjoy time away from school doing other things. Balance is a big part of it. AP courses are certainly things for everybody to consider. The recommendation from the teacher is a part of it, along with any prereqs classes that you have to take prior to. But I'm not going to read this entire paragraph. If you get towards the bottom, it's basically trying to let you know the expectation isn't that you try and take as many APs before you graduate. Everybody has their skills and strengths and interests. If you are interested in a particular area and are willing to give the extra time and effort that an AP class is requiring, and you have the background and the recommendation, that's great. But if you're taking a course just to take another AP, it is, especially for seniors, something that we really don't advise for a variety of things, because of what I said about all of your activities, as well as the fact that you need to focus on other aspects of your life. There are things outside of school that colleges care about beyond your academics, okay? So keep that in mind. Managing an extremely rigorous schedule makes it difficult to do some of those other things that are extremely valuable and what you very well would miss out on and potentially not be able to showcase for a college if you try and ramp up too much. New courses. I think I share this in the first period with both boys and girls, but just to repeat it, many of these are things that are coming back that we've offered in the past. Where it says possibly tennis, we actually are going to offer tennis, and that will be one of the opportunities that you could click on if you so choose. In English, where British literature is what was offered as an honors level English class for juniors and seniors this year, American Lit is what's being offered next year on the honors level. AP Biology is coming back. So is Earth, Space, Science, and Forensic Science. Again, we're offering it. Numbers will dictate whether or not it's actually a part of the master schedule, but if you have interest in those areas, by all means, by requesting them, that's the indicator and increases the chances of it being offered. I listed another course. It's really not as important for you guys because you won't be here. It says that the Engineering 1, it's really going to be something that younger students are interested in, and just knowing what the prereqs are for that class. Math modeling is coming back as well, half credit class. Some of you might have even participated in that class already. On the other side, we are offering an additional AP government course beyond the traditional American government program. It's a comparative government and politics class, half credit. American military history, sports psychology, those two. While we've had sports psych this year, it was a full year course. It's being offered as a half credit. And for religion, the cross of Christ, spirituality of music, in addition to ethics. So you'll see that as you're making your requests, as well as potential classes for you. Other classes that are also described in the curriculum guide would be the two dual enrollment courses that we offer on campus. We have the entrepreneurship class, and we also have this year an FIT introduction to law. Both of them require certain grades and test scores because you're actually taking a class through FIT. You have to meet certain standards that they have. There's actually an application process. They're well worth your time if, in fact, you are interested and are meeting the requirements and so forth. If you have questions about that, let us know. There is a cost factor because, again, it is a college course. We just are very fortunate to have these professors, these adjunct teachers coming to our campus, giving you that college experience, but here. Open elective, that is not new to you all, just reminding that you can take it. In terms of taking an open, you need to have 5 academic classes, that's the goal. Remember that while colleges wouldn't necessarily see your grades when you're first applying, they will see a list of classes that you're taking, and so you want to take the courses that are preparing you for areas that you say that you're interested in. Again, that's not taking all AP courses, I'm not suggesting that, but if you are taking beyond just one open elective, if it's not filled with what I'll say substantive kinds of courses, then they're going to wonder, why did they work so hard in junior year? And then all of a sudden start slowing down. So keep that in mind. The dual enrollment beyond the courses that I mentioned just a moment ago with the law and the entrepreneurship. If you are interested in other courses offered by FIT on their campus or virtual, or Eastern Florida, for example, we do allow students to take dual enrollment courses, but you have to get it approved. And the approval process includes you putting a form together. It's a dual enrollment proposal form. We'll make it available to you, but it's kind of early to necessarily know what is being offered at this point. It's a good time, though, to have those conversations. The general rule is if it's a dual enrollment class, it can't meet a graduation requirement, and it can't be something that we offer the AP equivalent of here on campus. Okay, so happy to talk about that with you if you're interested. Okay, the next several slides. These are more or less the flow charts that show the direction you go from one level of a class, from say junior high all the way through senior high, depending on your abilities and interests, and it goes by subject area. And depending on what math you're in, if you're trying to think logically about what comes next, this definitely will help you consider that. Factor in recommendations from teachers. Sometimes the path doesn't follow this exactly because some students might be able to move up in a direction based, again, on their more or less their performance in the class that they're currently taking, plus maybe even additional work on your part outside of class, and then the teacher recommendation. If there's ever a question about that, we are obviously going to work with you, but we also need to have the conversations with your teachers about it. Again, this is just an image that you will see, but it's extremely helpful in just thinking the overall plan. And the electives are listed to the side. You'll notice that stats is over there, by the way. It's not typically what we consider a traditional math class. That's not to say if you've got others up through, say, pre-calc, you very well could consider, or even advanced topics, you could consider the advanced placement statistics. Teacher rec is going to be an important part. Here's the English flow chart, and it's basically showing AP Lit and AP Lang as options, but also the American Lit and British Lit. You'll see how it flip-flops from year to year. Again, American Lit is what we're offering. And then over to the side, seminar and AP research as the elective capstone options. The science programming is showing honors tracking up through the AP science opportunity and college prep. Again, that's not new to you all. Engineering and technology. We did have the addition of some game development classes this year, and then we also have the computer science principles and computer science A. If you've never been involved with it, that's not to say that you couldn't consider one of those two AP classes. We'd need to talk and think through how much maybe experience you've had even on your own, because we do have students, particularly with the AP computer science principles, that go in and they do quite well, but you definitely have to have an interest in those classes as well. Social studies, World Civ, honors are regular, and then in terms of elective options, that would include things like American military history that we're adding in and so forth, as well as the psychology courses leading to You have to take U.S. History, honors or AP, which you're likely taking now. And then in senior year, you're taking government and economics. We do offer the AP levels. And one thing that's going to be different next year is the sequencing of the AP Gov and Econ. We'll talk more about that this afternoon. But essentially, if you're taking AP economics, it will be a second semester course in its entirety from January to May. And likewise, AP government, you'll have two options essentially. You could take the AP Gov, the new one, the comparative course, which would be a full semester course. If you're aware of the way it is right now, they have, if you take both AP levels, you're alternating between spending roughly 3 weeks with one teacher and 3 weeks with the other throughout the entire year. So, a little change in the way it's being offered. World languages, the leveling there, I think the big difference is with Latin 4 having come in. If you're a Latin student, it is now added so that that leads into AP. The journalism classes, Intro to Journalism is the gateway into broadcast and newspaper. Oftentimes students want to take one of those courses. Just know that there is an approval process there. You actually have to speak with Mr. Hale about applying for that class. If you are also interested in yearbook, notice that the journalism, the Intro to Journalism, is the precursor to that as well. And talking with those teachers, if you have any question about getting into those classes, easy enough. They'd be happy to work with you. For the visual arts and fine arts, again, the progression is somewhat consistent and easy to follow. You're going from level 1 to 2. Depending on ability and teacher approval, some students might go into portfolio. Portfolio is oftentimes really recommended before you take an AP because of the work that you can do prior to the AP studio opportunities. Work intensive and deadlines, it's rigorous in that regard, just to make sure that you have all the pieces that you need. Okay, so that's the curriculum aspect. All of that is in the book, and we will be helping you with that this afternoon. And you'll get instructions on exactly how to make the request, which is very simple. You've done it before, those of you that have been here. As far as the other slides, we are basically going to be talking a little bit about other things, a little more college planning related. This slide goes back to mentioning things that you might think about that could enhance your academic profile, such as taking a summer course, Eastern Florida, Florida Tech. If you did that, that's on you, and it doesn't really fall under our requirements based on the graduation requirements. It's like an enrichment opportunity. And you might even consider something like looking for a research experience or an internship. It's a way of kind of showing that you're using your time, your free time, for something extremely valuable. Work is a part of that as well. Global Citizens and STEAM applications, those were actually open and due back in December. As far as whether or not you actually qualify, that is a conversation you have with your advisors in your meetings to see how you're doing with all of the various requirements. There are planning sheets that are available in the college office, and you can think back through them. But again, it is taking our graduation requirements and ramping them up a little bit. For example, for the social studies piece, expecting students to take on an AP Euro or an AP World type of experience, or the extra language requirement, they're actually 4 instead of 3, that type of thing. If, again, lots of detail involved, I'm not going to take time to describe it. If you are interested in going through this and understanding it better, let me know. But there was an application that put your name on the list that was open, and technically we should have done that by December. Balancing things is going to be a big part of next year, making sure that you can handle your academic workload as well as dealing with your applications. Outside activities, we hope that you can maintain them because that is important as well. As I said, you need to be able to do other things. That's when you go to college, they want to know that you're not only able to balance all the various parts and pieces of being a student, but that you're going to get involved on their campuses as well. The admissions process today, I think that you'll find it very interesting and helpful to learn how the review actually takes place, at least from a private school perspective, different factors that go into determining student admission. Some of the things that are here are just some statistics to let you know about how colleges are viewing things. Grades in your classes are extremely important. That goes back to making sure that you're putting together a schedule that makes sense for you, that you can actually do the work and get good grades in those classes. Strength of curriculum, meaning that rigor. What are you taking? Are you taking some honors in AP? Not that you have to ramp it up all the way, guys. There is a reasonable load, and they are basically going to consider both parts, that you're doing well and that you're managing whatever workload that you happen to have. And then admissions test scores. Test scores, it's kind of a changing atmosphere right now. It's because, in part because of COVID and the fact that many schools have gone test optional. That trend, that opportunity for students to apply to a college without submitting scores, there have been schools that have been test optional for a while. We have more of them now than we did. But it hasn't gone away for some colleges. The state universities of Florida still require test scores. So keep that in mind. It's, even if you hear us talking about test optional opportunities, you need to think about timing, when you should take the tests, and trying to do the best you can for those schools that eventually you might be sending them to. Other factors beyond those more academic in nature type situations are your essays, which again, you're going to have some information given to you today with Mrs. Pedicini about getting started on those. Teacher and counselor letters of recommendation, and the importance of those can vary. I will say this, that as things like your test score importance, where that's going down, perhaps with certain schools, something else tends to replace. And in some cases, the emphasis on a teacher's recommendation or a counselor's recommendation, it very well could be elevated. Oftentimes, the essay portion has become more important to them, and a resume as well. The demonstrated interest in a college, have you taken a time to connect with them, whether it's virtually attending a session that they have or actually going to their campus? That interest, it may not be, you know, it's not going to seal the deal necessarily, but if down the road they've got two equally qualified candidates and one has taken advantage and gone and asked questions and really sought out information, and another student didn't, other than just sending in their application, if they're trying to evaluate who is a more seriously interested candidate, demonstrating your interest is definitely a way to let them know. And then extracurriculars. Extracurriculars, your resume, those different things that you do outside of your school is a way for them to learn more about you, and it is a way they're going to be able to evaluate whether or not you are going to be involved and connect with the culture of their school. So it is an important part, and it's something that you want to maintain as you continue through high school, not giving up those things because you can't handle it due to your academic load. Where to apply to school? Those final decisions aren't expected of you until we get back in the fall. So between now and then, taking advantage of the time to try and figure out a group of schools that you're interested in. You're not alone. We're here to help. But beyond that, taking advantage of tools that you have. SCORE, for one. SCORE is something that would allow you to do some research on your own. But then on top of that, spring break, I think, would be a great opportunity, even if you're not actually able to travel. If you could do some of the college fairs and some of the virtual visits, you start learning about the characteristics of schools and the types of schools that you're interested in, your job of piecing together a list will be a little bit easier. I apologize. This slide has Naviance reference there. That should be SCORE. Okay, we got rid of Naviance. getting the information from the schools. The other thing I will encourage you to consider, if you know of a college you're interested in and you are planning to go visit, if you tell us ahead of time, and we have students that are currently attending that school, we're happy to help you connect. And oftentimes you can get that insider's perspective from students that you may very well know fairly well. And they'd love to help you learn about the schools that they're attending. Developing your list, this is definitely something that we will work with you on as we're meeting together. All the parts and pieces, trying to help you refine your resume so that it looks really good, and talking about your academic and personal interests so that if there are recommendations we can make and offer about types of schools, that we put that in front of you so that you can learn about them as well. You're not going to like every single one, but those that you visit and learn about that you're like, this one's not for me, those are important situations and experiences too, because again, it's kind of like chipping away. You know, there's so many of them to consider. Making that evaluation and figuring out that fit for you is basically the whole idea. In terms of reviewing details about teacher letters of recommendation, how and when, that will come in the spring somewhat soon, actually, and your resumes are an important piece of that. Well, really, that's more for the counselor. And again, we'll give you more details as we get closer to our conference time frame. The resume for review, if you did not share it with your advisor, I encourage you to do that. I know I've met with a couple of students and would love to see more come my way. It's not expected to be perfect at this point. That's the whole idea. We try and help you with that. The testing part is another big part of the conversation too. So choosing where to apply, I mentioned SCORE already. You'll be on there today for the U Science activity. Interests and your academic area, of course, that's going to play a big part. You're going to school, so you know you want to be in a place that enables you to study what you think you're interested in, but your extras are important too. Are you going to be able to stay involved with dance? Are you going to be able to be in theater maybe and still consider a science major or something? Those kinds of things, again, help determine the fit for you. There are various things on SCORE, and I'm going to show you a couple of scattergrams and things that will help you determine even that academic fit for you from a historical perspective. The websites for the colleges, too. It's kind of intimidating sometimes. I don't know. Intimidating might be a strong word, but when you go to a college website, there's so much in there. If you've started with SCORE and learned a little bit about a school, and then focus on the admission section on the college website, there is a huge amount of information that can help you explore, particularly the academic part, but the student life as well. On SCORE, when you log in, there is an area that we've already had and encouraged you to work on, and that's the My College tab. The My College area has different lists. You can see some on occasion in the suggested column. A parent might put something in there. Your advisor might offer up a college for you to consider. But the three that you're basically in control of are the following: applying and applied. Applying and applied, we'll save those for next year. But as you uncover and are learning about schools, drag it to the following list. Not only will you know, regardless of where it is, you can click on the tile and you can learn more about that school. But if it's in the following list, your advisors know kind of what you're thinking about too. And again, we might make suggestions in that suggested list. So take a peek. The scattergrams, Naviance had scattergrams as well. This is what data is in there. It's information about Holy Trinity students that applied to the college that you're researching and what the outcome was. This is a historical perspective. You can't see it here, but the image that I took was a five-year, basically, history. And so what I'm pointing to, and I don't know if you can see, there's a star amidst those green dots. Can you kind of see the green star in there? All of those greens are students that were accepted. The student, you, or whoever's looking at this, your test score information and your GPA plot you on this map, okay? So if you don't see a star there, that's an indicator that you very well don't have any test scores in the system. So, and that happens as we get more information and we get those test score updates, eventually you would see. And the fact that the star is green is indicating that that student is sitting in an area indicating that their grades and test scores are very much aligned with a positive outcome, that they might be admitted to that school. This is based on two characteristics, though: test scores and GPA. Has no consideration for how the student wrote about themselves. It's not a guarantee, is my point. The other symbols and the other colors represent other outcomes. The yellow, you'll notice up at the very top, it tells you a word called deferred, and the red triangle, it says not accepted. And then there are some that are waitlist. Those terms are basically different scenarios based on what the college saw. The deny, the red is pretty clear. But the waitlist and defer basically is saying that the college is looking for more information, and it may or may not turn out that it's a positive or an admit situation. This one is for University of Florida. And I want you to just kind of look for a second and compare the percentages. That has to do with the selectivity of the college, obviously, okay? Both schools I picked were big ones so that you could kind of get an idea of number of applicants from year to year. And even with similar GPA and test scores, I'm going to show you another slide. What's interesting is where you see overlap, a red triangle over a green circle. If you were looking at this on your score account, if you hovered over and actually clicked on one of those symbols, you could find out some more detail about the student. And that's exactly what I did in this screenshot. I hovered over one of the red triangles. Obviously, you're not going to see the name or anything like that, but I do see the GPA and test scores. ACT of a 31, and a GPA, what does that say, 4.08? And their SAT was a 1250. I want you to keep in mind there's a green candidate, a green admit student underneath there. What would you think about that test score and that GPA? Is it a good applicant in terms of these two basic facts that you're given? I'd say yes, right? What you don't know is the point of this slide here. You don't know anything about their entire transcript, and what would a school be looking for? Maybe trends, you know, did they take a dip unexpectedly? Did their overall rigor go down? And then the other thing is, University of Florida has application essays. Do we know anything about what they wrote about themselves? No. Okay, so keep that in mind, that while scattergrams are helpful and it kind of gives you information about these more statistical or factual pieces, there are other factors that determine admission. Okay. Eventually, when you're dealing with the submission of applications, there are a variety of parts and pieces. We get into all those details next year. Right now, when you think about your grades, wrapping up junior year strong, guys, it's important because that's the last part that goes into the GPA a college sees, and you want good grades on there, just like I was using as an example in the UF slide. And next year, when you're applying as a senior, at first anyway, the courses are what they're going to see, eventually the grades. Hope that makes sense. Testing is coming up. If you have not signed up for tests, that's something to consider. You got to figure out what works in your schedule, and you got to also think about the prep part that goes into it. And this mentions some different prep opportunities, whether it's Khan Academy or using the ACT Academy. There are online resources. My hope is that we're going to have a test prep here on campus. I'd really hope that we'd get one in the spring, but it looks like we will be putting one together for the summer. So keep that in mind. Resumes, as far as parts and pieces of an app, you'll notice that I'm saying that we want a final version around April for letter of recommendation process. Now, Does that mean that it needs to be perfected today or this week? No. I already encouraged you, if you haven't submitted your resume to your advisor just for preliminary review, let's get that process going, okay, so that you'll be ready for the recommendation time frame. College essays, you'll learn more about the fact that we've got the teachers in the English department helping us. The more you work and get at least one good draft going, you'll have time over the summer to perfect it and maybe work on others so that the fall's a little bit easier again. There will be a meeting in the fall where we are going over all the nuts and bolts of applications, but that comes later on. Dealing with the test score stuff, when it comes to what scores to send and whether or not to send to a college, all of that, once we have that information, you'll be working with your advisor to make those choices. I will tell you this, for the schools that require test scores, keep in mind they are looking for the high, not the low. They also, I'd say, what percentage, Ms. Lugaro, super score. I mean, well over 90%. I can't think of any at this point that really don't super score. And for a long time, while they didn't do the ACT super scoring, they are doing it now. And what that means is if you've got two or three test dates, the fear of sending to those schools should be gone because they're going to take and keep the best parts of those different test dates that they have. It works to your advantage, obviously, for those schools that are requiring them. And whether or not you decide to go test optional to some schools, that's a consideration and a topic as your list of schools comes together. The only reason I really bring it up in that fourth bullet part, there are chances for you to send scores to colleges for free. And applications between the number of schools that you're applying to and the fees for testing, it doesn't hurt to cut back on some of the costs. Happy to go over that more with you. As far as what schools are test flexible or test optional, there is a website, FairTest, where you can actually see and get a list of all the various schools, or if you just have particular schools in mind, easy enough to go to their website and find out. The resume, this is kind of just a quick review. All the different things that you're involved with, putting it together, those things matter, but at the same time, it's also important not to try and have a 5-page resume. Focusing on the parts that are the most important. That's what we're going to try and get you to do. And don't hang on to things from middle school. Those things can go away. And if it was a standalone experience that is not related to what you want to study, sometimes tweaking it that way, as much as you might have felt like that ninth grade award was a super big deal, if you are limiting space to talk about a research experience that you've had more recently and keeping that ninth grade experience, you know, I'm going to tell you, some things can go, is my point. The things that go on it, variety. All, whether you work, your volunteer things, summer programs, interests that you're involved with, like some people are in scouting and have been for years, those kinds of things belong on there too. The teacher letter of rec, more instructions will come your way. It will involve score, and there are forms that you'll deal with on score when the time is coming. Right now, initial requests, we are planning to start around April 1, and we are more or less going to expect that those requests for one letter have been made before AP exam time frame. We need to know that the teachers have had information or been talked to about the letters of rec before you leave for the summer. Summer is when they would work on their first letters. Okay, that's more or less going to be a requirement. Okay, it's very difficult when we come back in the fall if you haven't made any requests. Counselor letter of recommendation that we write for the schools that need the letters of recommendation or scholarships, you don't have to ask us. However, what you need to do is provide us with that resume, and there are forms, again, that help us do our job. And the conversations through our conferencing, all of that is a way we get to know you. So please, please make sure that you take advantage and do what we need you to for both types of letters. And both are, depending on the school, some don't take recommendations at all. University of Florida, no letters of rec. Florida State, no letters of rec. Okay, so depending on the school, they can be extremely valuable though. Events coming up, well, today we've already, you know, this is a big deal, right? Your spring conference, watch for an email from Ms. Lugar or myself in the next couple of weeks. We're going to be signing or asking you to sign up for conferences where we can talk about your course requests, testing, the resume part, and looking ahead. How are you doing with all of the various parts and pieces that you can at this point work on? Dual enrollment proposals and so forth, that is referenced there as well. Again, let us know, because we would love to talk with you about it, and making teacher letters requests later in the spring. The other thing that I didn't emphasize there is it really does need to be an academic teacher and a current academic teacher that you're asking for those letters. Other things that we're hoping to be a part of your day or part of your experience before you're moving on to your senior year, the SAT, ACT prep course. Again, it's not a command thing. If we are offering it, it would just be an optional deal if you sign up for it. And the school is, I don't know if this is your circumstance, if you didn't do your religion and you don't want it to be a part of your senior year, there is planned a summer ethics class. Boot camp. Have you ever heard of our college application boot camp? College application boot camp is also not a command performance. The idea is that you'd come to school 4 days in June, four mornings basically, for roughly 3 hours. You'd work with Ms. Lugar and myself, plus we get guest readers to come. You work on your applications. It is like, let's get this going, let's fill out the app and do as much as you can. You get feedback so that, again, your fall is that much less hectic. And it mentions specifics, even interviewing, because that is an experience that you can have, and working specifically on apps like the Common App. And that's the end of this. Do you have questions? I threw a lot of information at you. A lot of it is going to be a part of those conferences that we'll be having. The curriculum information, for the most part, is in the curriculum guide that is now in your student resources, and you can access it this afternoon. This afternoon is when you'll get the details on just reminding you where to go and how to click and see what the teacher recommendations were and actually piece together the course requests that you have at this point, okay? The information that's on this slide, my intention is to share it with families as well, so you could refer to it again. No, I hope you didn't feel like it's something that you had to necessarily write down or anything. You'll see it again is my point. So, okay. Well, I will stop there. The next session three, make sure you're checking your schedule, and you'll see us in various parts of the campus. Anybody have a question? Okay. Thank you all.